Welcome, sports fans, to another exciting episode of StraussNet Sports Radio. I said it wouldn't be as long between episodes, and technically I was right. I did skip September. It's been busy. Excuses aside, here we are for October, our World Series preview edition. We have had the Major League Baseball postseason, and now it's time for the World Series. The two teams remaining are the Texas Rangers and the Arizona Diamondbacks. How did we get here? Well, let's take a look at the standings and kind of how the season happened. Standings. In the American League, let's just go division by division. The Baltimore Orioles finished with the best record of the entire American League. 101 wins. No one saw it coming. A lot of young talent. A lot of things going right for pitching. Not commenting on whether or not they'll be as good next year. They have a lot of young guys. Their offense will be there. But the Orioles, they managed to win that division. If you look at this division, it actually flipped on its head from what people thought maybe could happen. Tampa finished in second with 99 wins. Toronto, 89. Yankees, 82. And the Red Sox, 78. So my Boston Red Sox did not do their jobs this year. As a result, Chaim Bloom was relieved of his duties. Yesterday, Craig Breslow, their former left-hander from the 2013 World Championship team, was announced as their new president of baseball operations. He was working with the Cubs with Jed Hoyer as sort of an assistant GM. So we'll see how the Red Sox fix their problems. I think they're staying with analytics but going away from the lower spending that Chaim Bloom and the Tampa Bay Rays model. In the Central, the Minnesota Twins, by the way, the Rays were the other wild card team along with Toronto, but we'll get to the playoffs, the bracket in a moment. The Minnesota Twins won the AL Central, followed by the Detroit Tigers. Twins had 87 wins, Tigers 78, Cleveland 76, White Sox fell on their face to 61 and 101 losses. And Kansas City wasn't really expected to be great this year, but they only had 56 wins. The AL West was a roller coaster. It was eventually won by the Houston Astros at 90 wins, but tied with Texas, also 90 wins. Seattle, 88, they almost made it in. Angels, 73, and Oakland with an AL worst 50 wins. So going through the American League side of the bracket, we started with the... It started with the World Series there. We started with Texas and the Rays as the 4-5 seeds. The Twins played the Blue Jays as the 3-6. And obviously the top two division winners got the bye. We'll get more into the playoff bracket in a moment, but just sort of setting the stage. Astros, Orioles, and Twins, your division winners with the Rays, Rangers, and Blue Jays as the wild cards. So how did we get here? Well, like I said, the Red Sox and the Yankees fell on their face. The Blue Jays kept up. The Tampa Bay Rays were good, but lost some pitching and Wander Franco to a little bit of a personal issue that I won't get into too much. That he had an Instagram post with a girlfriend who they're investigating whether or not she was of age. So he's on leave from the team, potentially in a permanent manner. We'll find out. Baltimore kind of stuck with it wire to wire. Tampa got off to a great start, but Baltimore was consistent throughout the year, getting them to that 101 wins. In the Central, like I said, the White Sox, Cleveland, they didn't hold up to what they were supposed to do. Minnesota was just kind of good throughout, and they hung on. And they're a good team. The Pablo Lopez trade, getting him as an ace, even though you lose Luis Arraez in the process, I think both them and the Marlins got exactly what they needed in terms of that trade, a baseball trade, if you will. The West was the roller coaster, like I said. Texas coming from a 100-loss season 2 years ago and then not doing very well last year. They bring in Bruce Bochy. Remember, they brought in Semien and Seager last year. Chris Young, former pitcher, their GM, said, "I'm bringing in Bruce Bochy. Let's put the analytics books away. Let's just use it as a tool. Let's not build our entire franchise and our entire game plan based on what this algorithm says. Let's go play baseball." And so he got Bochy as a manager, the Hall of Famer from San Francisco, who kind of retired partially because of the analytics movement. And then you get into the pitching rotation. They go out and get DeGrom. They get Nate Eovaldi. John Gray is with them. And Andrew Heaney. So they build this big rotation. Martin Perez, who was an all-star in the last couple of years. So to build this rotation, they bring in Will Smith, former closer for Bochy with the Giants. They've still got Leclerc. Lowe is at first base. You've got Seager, Semien. Josh Young comes up. They bring in Leody Taveras, Move Adolis Garcia, the Cardinals' mistake, from center to right. And then Travis Jankowski and Robbie Grossman kind of hold down left field as a platoon. Remember last year, Mitch Garver was brought in, but then Jonah Heim did well. So this team was built as a baseball team. This is not an analytic team. They use it as a tool, but they are a good team. So they start the year with the best offense in baseball, one of the most consistent ones, and they end up, they lose DeGrom early, but Nathan Eovaldi steps in. I went and saw these guys in June when the Cardinals went in. Very impressive team. The stadium's very nice, especially for being indoors. Doesn't feel as indoorsy. I feel like the roof is pretty high, and that helps. A lot of windows, a lot of ways to make this park look nice. It was just an overall really nice experience. I was on the radio yesterday talking about how I kind of was excited about this team throughout the year. I picked them at the trade deadline to go to and potentially win the World Series from the American League. I'm still a Cardinal fan and a Red Sox fan, but I've adopted this team for the postseason. I'm very excited about their personalities, their team. I really like them, so I'll be curious to see how interesting they are to me moving forward. I've told people, I'm okay with bandwagoning a little bit. If you're a fan of a sport, jumping on with a team, as long as you're not, abandoning your own teams, it's okay to follow some teams here and there. I followed Tom Brady to Tampa, but my interest in Tampa has waned. My dad likes the Tampa Bay Lightning, even though they're not really his team. He's a Blues fan. So, what I essentially wouldn't admit on air yesterday was I am on the Texas Rangers bandwagon for this postseason. But a lot of fun players. Like I said, people like Seager, Semien, DeGrom, and we'll get to their second half. So they jump out in front. Houston, remember, the Mets signed Justin Verlander away from them. So it was on Framber Valdez, who was an all-star in the first half, but had a rocky second half. And Seattle made the playoffs last year for the first time in years. So we have high hopes for these three teams throughout the first half. Angels still kind of being the Angels. A lot of talent, not really putting it all together. And Oakland was the worst team in baseball, I believe. And so, in the second half, we get the trade deadline. Astros trade for Verlander back as the Mets fall out of things. And the Rangers traded for Max Scherzer from the Mets. So they each add an ace. Scherzer supposedly replacing, in theory, replacing DeGrom. So you got him, Eovaldi, John Gray pitching pretty well. They also add Jordan Montgomery from the Cardinals, a year removed from him being traded by the Yankees. Montgomery kind of came into his own with the Cardinals and Yadier Molina last year at the end of the year and continued that with St. Louis this year. Very consistent. They let him off the leash and kind of no longer a five-inning pitcher. And he really blossomed with the Cardinals and then possibly even more so here in Texas when we get into the postseason part of things. So Texas coming down to the wire. The last week of the season, they needed to win three or four games to win the division. They led the division all year, but the Astros heated up at the right time. The problem was the Astros clobbered Texas in Arlington late in the season that really kind of helped tighten that division up. We had a three-team race heading into the last week where there were scenarios where Seattle and Houston got in, but Texas didn't. And it went down to the final series where Texas played, over the last week, Texas played at home versus Seattle versus the Angels in Anaheim and then at Seattle. The Astros would play Texas and Seattle and then go to Arizona. And it ended up happening that Texas only won one of a final four-game set in Seattle. They needed to win two to win the division. But there was a scenario where if they won one game, and the Astros only won a certain number of games, Texas could actually be out of the playoffs. It didn't work out like that, but they did get shut out 1-2 on the last day of the season. Let's take a look at that just to be sure what that score was. I remember watching that, and that was a big, big deal. The last day of the season, there's Arizona going back through the playoffs, and where am I? October 1st. Yeah, 1-0. 1-0 at Seattle, and that you score two runs, you're the division winner. So there was a little bit of panic there after that happened, that maybe Texas wouldn't get in the playoffs or they would just get swept out of it after such a good year. I actually put a little money on them after, in the middle of the week, they won 2 or 3 against the Angels. Well, after they lost the middle game against the Angels, I went and put some money on them to win the pennant, the Rangers that is, the pennant, and then a little more to win the World Series. I figured, all right, after a loss, their number's going to go up and the screws are tightening. Now, the reality is the number to take was after the last game of the year when they lost the division to the Astros. And I think they got fired up by a lot of that. I think things settled down as we look at their path to the playoffs. The Astros posted a video when they won the division, Alex Bregman saying, a lot of people wonder what would happen if the Stros didn't win the division. I guess we'll never know. And I know that was bulletin board material. This is a very professional Ranger team. I know Adolis Garcia gets excited, but they're not going to talk a lot about it. They're not going to give bulletin board material most of the time. They use this kind of as a lightning rod. They're like, well, we have to reset. We can't be... They said they were trying to hit too many homers and win the games instantly in Seattle. They reset on their way to Tampa Bay. That was the big... that was the wild card matchup. And it was definitely... a little bit stressful to watch because Tampa Bay, remember, they won 99 games and you're in Tampa and you're going up against glass now. And the Rangers weren't going to have Scherzer because he actually hurt himself in September. So, you know, they're going in with Eovaldi, who was coming back from a late season injury and rehabbed in the majors and wasn't very good during that period of time. Again, he's rehabbing. So they're going with Montgomery in Game 1, who they just got. No Scherzer. Eovaldi, kind of, would he be good enough to go? Is he still rehabbing? John Gray got hurt like the last week of the season. He was actually supposed to pitch the last Saturday of the regular season to try to get them in the playoffs. They had to start Andrew Heaney because Gray had like a forearm strain. So it was all falling apart for him at the wrong time. They go into Tampa. They take 2 pretty easily. And they say, look, we had to come together. We had to go, look, hey, just play baseball. And that's what they did. And I think Bruce Bochy's calm, guiding hand was the best way for that to happen. So Rangers get out of the wild card series. I kind of kept saying, well, I've spent a week waiting for them to win 1 or 2 games to get into the division series. And they did. So it was on to Baltimore, the 101-win team from the American League East. And they clobbered them. Game 1 was tight. They had to start Andrew Heaney again because, you know, Montgomery pitched Game 1 of the Wild Card Series and was great. And then Eovaldi was fantastic in Game 2. But that left them with no one for Game 3. So Andrew Heaney opened up. He wasn't an opener. He pitched a few innings. And then they turned it over to Dane Dunning and company. But they got it done. They also had rebuilt their bullpen towards the end of the year. Leclerc started closing games. They traded for Aroldis Chapman, who was a nightly coin flip of how wild would he be, and Josh Spores, who was doing a good job. So they're able to kind of rebuild their bullpen last minute, get into this postseason tournament, which is what it's become. I'm not a huge fan of the new format. Too many teams in. I don't hate the 3-game wild card set, but I'm not a huge fan of all the teams getting in. It's weird. We'll talk a little more about the World Series result when we get to that point in October, but let's just stay on the chronological track. All of the wild card series were sweeps, and pretty much all of the big division winners fell, except for Houston. You know, Minnesota was... Remember, it's top 2 get the bye. So Baltimore fell to the Rangers. Houston did not. They beat Minnesota. And then on the NL side, you had Atlanta, Milwaukee, and the Dodgers. Milwaukee being the 3. Atlanta and the Dodgers went out in the first round. Now, I'm not saying I think that this favors the teams that start first. I definitely last year said it's possible that you get a hot team or maybe a team that snuck into the playoffs feeling some momentum while other teams are resting up maybe the last week of the season, maybe during the break. I'll also say that even in the old wild card system where they'd play on Tuesday and then the other game on Wednesday, the division series didn't start till Friday or Saturday anyway. So teams were already getting rest. In this case, you just have more teams. So I don't know. I mean, I don't like the system to begin with, but I don't think the three-game wild card set is the problem. I think it's too many teams, and you have too many teams who are pushing, getting hot at the last minute, and other teams saying, well, we're going to get the bye, so let's just calm down. So I don't know. But it, like, I'm enjoying the fact that there's some new faces, but also it's really diminished the regular season. But again, I'll touch on that later when we get to our World Series preview. So the Rangers go to the division series. They smoke the Orioles. Like I said, game one was close, but games two and three, after, especially after a Mitch Garver grand slam in game two. Oh, and lest I forget, they have a new left fielder. It's not Travis Jankowski and Robbie Grossman anymore. It's the young Evan Carter, who only spent about a week at AAA. He's only 21. They brought him up when Adolis Garcia got hurt late in the year, and he's been really, really good. He's got a great eye at the plate, sees a lot of pitches, so he slots in as the left fielder as Adolis Garcia goes back to right field. And as Bruce Bochy started shuffling the lineup around, Carter ended up in the three spot, actually. Late in the year, first baseman Nate Lowe, after the whole infield went to the All-Star game, Lowe scuffled a little bit. He seems to be getting back on track, but they were trying to figure out early in the postseason, you know, who's our three hitter? They lead off Semien, they put Seager second, and they like to stick with that. So even though one of those guys could hit third, they like Adolis Garcia four because he's not a great on-base contact guy. He swings for the moon a lot, but they like somebody else third. They tried Robbie Grossman against lefties. Garver ended up hitting third early in the postseason, and I think that was a good move, a professional hitter. So Garver, then you got Adolis. And then Josh Young went out for a while. Like, most of this team got hurt at one point or another. Seager got hurt at one point, too, even. Semien's the only guy who played every game. So there's a little bit of shuffling lower in the lineup. And Carter moved all the way up to that three spot, shuffling Garver down a little bit, Lowe and Young kind of lower in the order to get them out of the funk they're in. It just kind of all fell together right at the right time, kind of in that division series. It was like, oh, the Tampa series was to get everything back on track, but everything was rolling once they got through Baltimore. And then they would get their wish. It was on to Houston. They would get to play those Astros that they finished with the identical record of 90-72, but because of the late season series, the Astros got the head-to-head tiebreaker. They would host games 1 and 2 and win the division. So the Texas Rangers would have their shot at their cross-state rivals who like to talk a lot. Now, those Astros, we are several years removed from the cheating scandal, but a lot of people still feel like they got away with murder. They cheated. The players didn't get punished at all because of grievances, and they felt, I think MLB felt like they wanted to get the whole story to make a show of them. So they gave them, they let them have the pass in terms of the players. They got rid of front office people, coaches, managers, and then 2020 happened with no fans in the stands. We learned about this in 2019, the trash can bang from 2017, and then whistling in 2019. There's rumor of a buzzer in Jose Altuve's shirt. It was a whole thing, if you don't remember. Go look it up, check it out. But a lot of baseball, they were ready to boo the crap out of the Astros, and then 2020 happens. And, you know, a year removed, everyone's just happy to have baseball back. The Astros kind of go by the wayside until they get back to the World Series again in 2021 and 22. And some of these, you know, a lot of these players aren't the same players. I said this last year around World Series time. I wouldn't hold them winning the World Series again, you know, a clean one. I wouldn't hold it against them. I was kind of happy for their replacement manager of A.J. Hinch, Dusty Baker, to get him a World Series. So the Astros won the World Series in 17. They went to the ALCS and lost the eventual champion Red Sox in 18. They lost the World Series in 19 to the Nationals. They went to the ALCS in 20 with a losing record over the two-month season. Eventually, Tampa Bay Rays would beat them and then get beat by the Dodgers. In 21, they beat the Red Sox in a six-game series. I thought the Red Sox were going to beat the Astros, but they would go to the World Series but lose to the Atlanta Braves. And then last year in 22, beat the Phillies to win the World Series again. So they've been in seven straight ALCS, and they've been to the 17, 19, 21, and 22 World Series. That's four of them over this seven-year span, including this year, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, and 23. So the Astros looking like they might be back. The one thing is, the Rangers have played very well on the road, and oddly enough, so have the Astros. But the Astros have played worse at home than almost anybody in baseball. It was strange. So games 1 and 2, Rangers end up taking games 1 and 2. They played a 2-0 game with Jordan Montgomery in the mound in game 1. They go up 4-0 early against Framber Valdez in game 2. They end up making a 5-4 final. They're going home. They're going home with a lead. All they have to do is win 2 of 3. And they've got Max Scherzer back. John Gray is in the bullpen because he wasn't stretched out. Scherzer's been throwing the whole time, according to Bruce Bochy. So Scherzer's on the mound in Game 3. Well, he's a little bit wild. We're doing the thing with Nathan Eovaldi all over again. A little bit wild. His velocity's good. I believe he had a lat strain or something. I can't remember. But he's a little bit wild, gives up some runs early. Rangers fight back a little bit, but they aren't able to close the deal. So they do lose Game 3. Game 4, they start Andrew Heaney again. He only goes a third of an inning. And then the Astros pile on. Dane Dunning comes in. But the Rangers fight back again. 3-3 tie. And then it all falls apart. Wheels come off. The Astros end up winning like 10 or 11 and 3. So the series is tied. So all this talk about each team doing well on the road, and it's tied. All the momentum the Rangers had, it's gone. Game 5 in Texas. That's going to be a rematch of Game 1. You beat Verlander once. Can you do it again? Well, the Astros got out early, but then Adolis Garcia with a big, big home run. He slams the bat on the ground, rounds the bases, and the Rangers are up 4-2. Three-run homer. Going to the ninth inning, well, bottom of the eighth, they get a couple of guys on, and then Astros pitcher Abreu hits Adolis Garcia. This was the only controversy really during this series. Now, they'd hit him a couple of times this year. The Astros have hit the Rangers multiple times this season. The Rangers didn't like it. There was a little bit of a bench-clearing incident earlier in the season. So there's some history. There's a little bit of bad blood here. We all know the Rangers weren't happy with the end-of-season comments about, well, we all wondered what would happen if the Astros didn't win the division. I guess we'll never know. And so Adolis Garcia turns around and yells at Martin Maldonado, who supposedly said something back to him to try to rile him up more. Abreu gets a 2-game suspension, which eventually would be pushed to next year so that he would be available for the rest of the series. Guys get thrown out. Dusty Baker gets fined. He gets ejected. But Jose Leclerc is sitting on the bench for 20-30 minutes while the inning is unfolding, and then the fighting is happening, and then, you know, who's getting kicked out, the umpires. So he had actually come in to get the last out of the previous inning, four-out save situation, because Chapman got into trouble. Well, the Astros put the first two on, and Jose Altuve happened. He hits a three-run homer, giving the Astros a 5-4 lead in a soul-crushing loss. Rangers actually put two guys on. All they needed was a run, and Semien hit a ball that was caught by the leaping shortstop. This game was the game of the series in terms of back and forth, being intense, and it went the Astros' way. Heading back to Houston with one win to go, Nathan Eovaldi would have to be on the mound for the Rangers to save their season, and that would be against, once again, Framber Valdez. And the Rangers took care of business. They went out, they got a lead early. It was tight until late when Adolis Garcia hit a mammoth grand slam and silenced the crowd, sent people to the exits. We would be tied going to Game 7. Max Scherzer versus Christian Javier, who threw the combined no-hitter last year in the World Series. So the Rangers get a huge lead. Javier doesn't even make it out of the first inning, and it's never even in question. Adolis Garcia hits two more home runs. Big game gets him ALCS MVP. The Rangers headed to the World Series for the first time since 2011, where the David Freese fiasco happened to them by my Cardinals. And joy in Arlington as they are able to beat the Astros. Most of baseball was rooting for Texas because they just did not want to see the Astros go back. But again, I contend this is a very, very, very fun team to watch. Very professional. It's really hard to dislike anyone. As a traditionalist, I understand people who don't like some of the excitement by Adolis Garcia, but he's not as bad as some of the other players are about it. And again, how much of that was for the Astros? I guess we'll see if he does more in the World Series. This was kind of a coming out party for this group. Remember, they lost 100 games a couple years ago. They weren't good last year. And they're set to be good for a while. They're going to have Scherzer again next year. By the way, Scherzer only went a few innings. His command was shaky, but wasn't as bad as before. Jordan Montgomery with a big bridge in the middle of that game seven. You know, Montgomery's a free agent. He's going to make some money. Evaldi's still there. Scherzer's still there. DeGrom will be back next August, hopefully. They should still have Gray and Haney and Dunning. We'll see. But this team is set up to be good for a long time, especially now with this Carter kid coming up and just being a professional hitter. So, Rangers head to the World Series. I collected my money the other day for winning the pennant. We will see if they can win me some more here. That was with FanDuel's, actually. So usually I would list the Yahoo numbers, but I have a FanDuel. I have access to FanDuel's in person here where I live, so I've been going and doing that and made myself a little bit of money. But again, like I said, I've jumped on the Rangers bandwagon for this postseason. We'll see how that goes moving forward. But I like this particular team. You know, a couple of years ago, I was all about the San Diego Padres as kind of an outsider team that I had some interest in, and that faded. So, if you love sports, if you love a particular sport, if you like players, I know a lot of people who follow players. You know, I've liked DeGrom. I've liked Max Scherzer. I love Nathan Eovaldi. And again, I'm associating this team with a trip that I took. Like, I was an Orioles fan when I was a kid because I went there every year because we had relatives out there. I love the Baltimore Orioles. I appreciate them. I support them. I hope they win. I was glad they had a great season, but I wouldn't call myself an Orioles fan at this point. So we'll see how the Rangers are for me. All I'm saying is don't judge me or your brother or your sister on if they're picking up a team just because, you know, it's kind of an interest at the moment. It's okay to bandwagon a little bit, to adopt a team, as I'll say. You know, isn't that the point, to enjoy sports? Know your teams, know who you're rooting for, but you can adopt a team. Either way, I digress. Let's look at the National League side. Let's take a look at the Arizona Diamondbacks' road to the postseason. And they kind of went the same way. So let's start with looking at all the divisions, and then I'll get to Arizona. So Atlanta was the best team in baseball, 104 wins, three more than those Baltimore Orioles. They led the 90-win Phillies, who are the defending National League champions, and then the Miami Marlins at 84 wins. They were your other wild card team. The Mets and the Nationals fell off. The Mets only with 74 wins, then the 71-win Nationals. The super team of the Mets did not work, and the Mets have said, you know what, we're taking a step back, we're going a different direction. It's part of why they ended up trading Verlander and Scherzer. Scherzer went and asked Billy Epler, hey, are you guys competing next year? And he said, probably not. And so he's like, okay, you can trade me, and then Verlander eventually as well. And so they end up both in Texas, one in Arlington, one in Houston. Never did face off against each other, but you know, if you're the Astros and the rich get richer there, where they get their ace back, and they'll have him next year. I think both guys were on 2 year, maybe Scherzer on a. I think Scherzer had 2 years and an option, and he took the option in going to Texas. That was part of it. They wanted him to take the option, and they had no trade clauses, and they were both they both accepted the trades. So the Mets kind of winding down. Meanwhile, in the Central, which we've talked about all year, the Milwaukee Brewers were the team that ended up hanging on. My Cardinals were bad from the start. They were only 500 for like 3 days. They were only above 500 for 1 day. Like the third day of the season, they went 2-1 against Toronto to open their season. And then lost to Atlanta, and they were at 500, and then lost to Atlanta again, and then they were under 500. And that was it. That was the only time this year they were either above 500 or 500. For those of you who don't know, 500 means even record. So 1-1 is 500. 2-1 is above 500. One win and two losses is below 500. So the Cardinals won their lost their first game, won their second game, won their third game, and that was it. They got to 500, they were above, and then they lost, and they were never back to being an even record. They finished in last, 71 wins. It was really unfortunate. And they need pitching. We saw Adam Wainwright retire. Thank you so much for a great career, Wainwright. We found out that he had torn something in his shoulder late in the season. He said he thinks he did it like the last couple of weeks, but you got to imagine that was going on all year. That's why he was so bad at times. He did get to his 200th win, thank goodness. My childhood kind of died there because no Pujols, no Yadi, and now Adam Wainwright, as of yesterday, officially retired. So congrats on a great career, Adam Wainwright. St. Louis Cardinals, it's on you. You need to go get some pitching. We'll talk about that in an off-season episode, maybe who we're looking at. I'd like to see maybe an Aaron Nola, a Sonny Gray, a Yamamoto, maybe get Jordan Montgomery back. We'll see. I think Montgomery might stay with the Rangers, but Cardinals need to do something to get that rotation going again. The only team better than them in the National League, they were tied with the Nationals, and the only team worse than them, was Colorado in the National League. In terms of American League, Kansas City, Chicago, White Sox, and Oakland were all worse than them. So Cardinals tied for the second worst record in the National League. So Brewers won the division. The Chicago Cubs, as I predicted, this is like the only prediction I got right for the entire season. I said the Chicago Cubs were going to be one of the bubble teams and one of the last teams not to make the playoffs. So like one of the first teams of the non-playoff teams. At 83 wins, Cody Bellinger was great for them. Steele was great. Up and down season from the rest of their pitching staff. But they have things to build on. Will they bring Bellinger back? Who will they replace him with? Cubs put up a run for the division, but Milwaukee ended up winning. At 82 wins, the Cincinnati Reds saw young guys like Ellie De La Cruz take over and really shine. They had a chance to win the division. Next year, if the Cardinals don't get it together, yeah, this division is going to be a little tougher because the Brewers are still going to be decent, I'd like to think. I still say they don't have enough in the middle of their order, but maybe they go out and make some moves and make it even better. The Cubs are probably going to be better unless, you know, there was a letter to season ticket holders that said that they were going to rely on internal options, and that always scares you as a fan. But if the Cubs can recapture this year's magic and maybe get better, they're still in the building process. Think the 2014 Cubs that didn't make the playoffs but were causing trouble at the end of the year for other teams. And then you got the young Reds. Pittsburgh obviously is not necessarily going to be what their fans would probably like them to be. So if you could get Milwaukee, Chicago, Cincinnati, and St. Louis all being contenders next year for that division if the Cardinals fix what they need and the Cubs go out and add to what they had this year or replace Cody Bellinger. In the West, the Dodgers held form. They ended up winning the division yet again. But that's not for lack of competition. And no, it wasn't San Diego. A lot of people thought with Xander Bogaerts and company that this would be San Diego's chance to take the division. Dodgers losing Justin Turner. Urias ended up leaving the team late in the year due to a domestic violence issue. San Francisco Giants kind of regressed. San Diego's manager Bob Melvin is actually going to be the Giants' next manager. We'll see who manages the Padres. Could be former Cardinal manager Mike Schilt. And the Rockies kind of fell flat with a 103-loss season. Dodgers, Diamondbacks, Padres, Giants, and Colorado. But the Diamondbacks showed early in the season. You know, I'll say, my dad said back in our spring training episodes, look out for Arizona. They have a good team. Well, early in the year with Zach Gallen, Merrill Kelly, and some of the other guys they had, they put on a show and they led the division. The Dodgers did end up putting them down. Arizona slumped in like the middle third of the year or the three-fourths through the year, that third quarter of the season. They kind of slumped a little and that let the Dodgers in to win the division, but it didn't end up mattering as we foreshadow that they are our National League champion, the Diamondbacks. Like I said, San Diego did not hold up their end. We'll see if they can come back stronger next year, but they may lose Blake Snell, so that could hurt them. Arizona's young. Guys like Corbin Carroll and company. They end up adding Tommy Pham. The young Brandon Fought, for all those who think his name is Paft or Fat, it's Fought, like I fought you in the parking lot. He actually wasn't that good when he came up initially, but then later got pretty good. As the postseason's gone on, he's evolved. He's learning. Very young guy. So Diamondbacks get into the postseason. There was actually the battle between them and the Cubs and Miami. That was really about it. Cincinnati. Cubs and Cincinnati on the outside looking in. Philly gets top wild card. Miami ends up with the second wild card. And Arizona had to go to division winner Milwaukee to finish out to play the wild card series. And Like I said, none of the wild card games went three game series went three games. So they won in two with ace Zach Gallen. They actually end up pitching fought in the first game of the wild card because they needed Gallen at the end of the season to help close the gap and clinch a playoff spot. So the Diamondbacks, they go up against the Brewers. They win that one 2-0. They beat the Dodgers 3-0. That was the stunner. Like, I thought that was going to be a five-game series. I thought the Diamondbacks should definitely beat them, but I thought that'd be deeper. Really, there were two sweeps across the entire division series, and there were no five-game series. The Astros and Twins went four. The Twins winning game two behind Pablo Lopez. And remember, they had to change things up because of the wild card series. So your game one starter for the wild card ended up pitching game two. Meanwhile, the defending National League champion Phillies, who seemed like they were on a mission from God, they've got Nola, they've got Wheeler, and they've been managing Ranger Suarez through his starts, almost like the Andrew Heaney situation or the Max Scherzer, where he was going through the rotation, the order a time or two, and then coming out. They did a good job managing their team, but they get Bryce Harper back. He ends up being the first baseman, even though they lose Rhys Hoskins. Schwarber's hitting bombs. Castellanos did pretty well early in the postseason. They knocked out the Marlins, the Sandy Alcantara-less Marlins, have you. But then they go up against the Braves, and they win Game 1. They shut them out in Game 1. Game 2, a wild finish where there was a ball hit to the wall. The Braves actually made a comeback on a big home run late in the game, but then by Austin Riley. And then the Phillies were able to put guys on in the ninth inning. Ball hit deep to the wall. Caught at the wall by Michael Harris. Harper's doubled off first base because he was going. Like, if he scores, he ties this game. But then the Phillies take care of business at home, and people are thinking, wow, this team's the team to beat in the National League. So the 4-6 seeds are playing in the National League Championship Series, while the 2-5 Astros-Rangers in the American League. Phillies go up 2-0. They trash the Diamondbacks in Games 1 and 2 at Citizens Bank Park in Philadelphia. And people are thinking, just like with the Rangers series, it's over. Philly can win 2-3 in Arizona. Arizona has a nice comeback in Game 3. They end up winning Game 4. But Zach Wheeler takes care of business as the Phillies win Game 5. So we're going to Philadelphia. Very similar to the other series, the Texas and Astros at this point, where it was a different route, but the favored team, all they have to do is win one of two home games with Nola on the mound this time. Well, Nola gets beat up pretty good, and the Diamondbacks are able to win Game 6, and then they held the Phillies down in a tough Game 7 with Brandon Fought on the mound. And the Diamondbacks are your National League champions. A lot of people figured in this post, if there was anything I thought that was guaranteed in this postseason, even though I had money on Texas, with the way the Phillies started the playoffs, even in the wild card series, I thought the Phillies were going back to the World Series. But they're not. That's the Texas Rangers hosting the Arizona Diamondbacks, a 5-6. I guess the Rangers would have hosted even if Philly, even though they're the 4, because the Rangers had the better record than Philadelphia. Let's take a look here real quick. Rangers, I said 90 wins, and Philadelphia, well, they also had 90 wins. So I guess the Rangers had some sort of tiebreaker here where they would have been the host of the American League team was going to host the National League between the two Texas teams. So here we are to the World Series. We have the Texas Rangers and the Arizona Diamondbacks. It's not a matchup that a lot of people thought they would have. It's not a high media market. Well, technically Dallas really is. It's interesting because the Rangers are kind of seen as a mid-tier market for TV because they're not viewed as one of the gems of baseball. Like, it's kind of like the Dallas Stars in hockey. It's not like the Cowboys, where the Cowboys are like the end-all, be-all, it feels like, in the football world. It's more like a St. Louis thing. Texas Rangers are not. They're not the Yankees, the Red Sox, the Dodgers. They're not even seen like the Angels are. Houston's gotten a lot of attention by being, you know, as good as they've been. But the Texas Rangers aren't viewed as a big market. Meanwhile, Arizona, definitely not a big market for any of the sports. The Coyotes, the Arizona Cardinals, former St. Louis football Cardinals. So this is kind of seen as a matchup of low media teams. And there's a lot of people criticizing this in the media, talking about how, well, good luck with your World Series, MLB. You got two teams that no one wants to watch. This is kind of what I was alluding to earlier. I don't like the playoff format because it really did. You had 2 years in a row, you had, yes, the Astros, but the Phillies, the sixth seed, barely getting in, getting past the Cardinals. And now you have the Rangers not necessarily sneaking in with as good a season they had, but a team that fell off, got in, got it together in the wild card series, and a team of the Arizona Diamondbacks who also snuck into the playoffs. Even though they were good in the first half, they weren't really in the second half. They were a six. You know, these two teams, you go a few years back, the Rangers would have got in, but not the Diamondbacks. They wouldn't even be in the playoffs. So you're not getting the best two teams in baseball. Now, at one point, you would have said, yeah, the Rangers are one of the best two teams in baseball with how they were playing, but they fell apart. So that's hindsight. This playoffs did not play to the strengths of the regular season teams. Again, the Rangers and the Diamondbacks were great in the first half. It's kind of like the Red Sox in 21. They won. Now, that was regular playoff. That was the regular, whatever is regular anymore. The 2021 was the last year of the single wild card elimination game. The Red Sox were really good in the first half. They fell off in the second half. They snuck back into the playoffs. They beat the Yankees in the wild card game. They beat the Rays in the division series and lost to the Houston Astros in a six-game ALCS. That's kind of what this Ranger team reminds me of. They were good in the first half. Injuries came about. They made it in anyway. Diamondbacks remind me of last year's Phillies. You know, you'd think that the Diamondbacks have a good team, but they were not exactly a powerhouse all year. So we have two underdogs. So in the same sentence, I'll say I don't like the playoff format, and I love that it's someone new. My buddy Tim always roots for the underdogs, the teams that haven't been there. Well, we got a team that is still relatively one of the newer teams in the league, in the Diamondbacks. They won the first World Series they appeared in 2001 against the Yankees, the Luis Gonzalez walk-off. And they had great players like, you know, Schilling, Randy Johnson, you know, like I said, Luis Gonzalez, all sorts of great, you know, they had that Randy Johnson and Curt Schilling closing out the game in both pitching in Game 7. You know, they have a good history. They went back to the LCS in 2007 but fell to the red-hot Colorado Rockies. Diamondbacks have had some good teams over the years. This one, what's interesting about this one is they're so young, they're going to build on this. They should be a force. You know, Corbin Carroll, they've got Ketel Marte still, Zach Gallen, another guy the Cardinals cast off in a trade. Merrill Kelly's a good pitcher. Now we'll see how Brandon Fought does. This year's Michael Wacha, potentially. A guy who comes out of nowhere and big prospect, but gets it done at the right time. So I'm really excited to see these two new faces. The Rangers have never won a World Series, despite playing in the 2010 and 2011 World Series. I believe this is their third appearance. Yes, the 2010 and 2011 World Series were their first two. Remember, they were the Washington Senators, but at least as the Texas Rangers, they are the expansion Senators. The original Washington Senators are the Minnesota Twins. So they have not been to the World Series besides these three times, and we'll see if third time's a charm and they get that World Series trophy. My buddy Jeffrey, who's from Oklahoma, he worked with me at the restaurant a little bit. I've been texting back and forth with him, and he said the 2011 kind of made him stop watching baseball for a while, but I got him to start watching again. I said, enjoy this team. No matter what happens, enjoy it. It's a fun year. Going to the World Series is always fun. You know, I always tell people, this is some of the most fun time as you lead up to Game 1 because you're celebrating winning something. There's going to be a banner at Globe Life Field next year for winning the pennant. Win or lose, be proud of this. You know, I always talk about the division. Well, you've won your league. It's a big deal. But you do want to win, but the lead up to Game 1, it's just kind of this celebration and everything's great, especially when you're hosting Game 1. And then the game starts and, you know, Game 1 happens and then you're really into it. But I've told them, enjoy this because it doesn't always happen. And look how long it's been since the Rangers were in. a lot of people talk about, is this the end for the Cardinals? You know, Cub fans, it took them forever to get there. It's just enjoy being there one way or another, and then you hope to win it. I say it about the Super Bowl. Enjoy being there. So, Texas fans, Arizona fans, I have another restaurant friend who's he's from Arizona, and he's a big fan of the team, the Arizona Diamondbacks. He took work off. They gave him work off the other night so he could watch Game 7, and I'm sure he was excited, and I am excited to see how he feels heading into this World Series. But yes, the Texas Rangers have not won a World Series, and the Diamondbacks have, despite being the younger team. So we'll see how things turn out here. If I had to make a prediction, I would say the Rangers are going to win this in 5 or 6. I am optimistic. I think things are really coming together for them. They finally kind of found their lineup. Their rotation's coming together. Scherzer a little bit better this time out. Maybe he can go a full start. They really only need him 1 or 2 more times, potentially for a Game 7. We've already announced that Zach Gallen will face Nathan Eovaldi in Game 1. I'm going to assume Merrill Kelly and Montgomery in Game 2. Fought and Scherzer in Game 3. That'll be in Arizona, obviously. So, I think the Diamondbacks are good. I think this young talent's there. It's almost like the Rangers playing the Orioles again, where you're facing the young team, but this team has better pitching than the Orioles did. The Orioles never really got the ace they needed. Jack Flaherty didn't pan out for them. They end up going with, Kramer and Bradish. I think in this particular case, with Zach Gallen and Merrill Kelly, a couple of proven, well, one's a vet and the other one is a young but very, very talented. I think this would be a really fun World Series to watch. No rivalry for me. No one that I always talk about who would you rather beat and who would you rather lose to. I didn't want to see the Astros beat the Rangers, but I could have survived if it was the Twins who beat the Rangers. Well, nothing here. I'd like to see the Rangers win this World Series, but if the Diamondbacks win, my cap's off to them. No hard feelings in any way. I definitely think the Diamondbacks can win, though. And so here's how it breaks down for me. If the Rangers win the first 2 games of this series in their ballpark in Texas, I think it's pretty much over. I think the Rangers, like they did with Houston, can find a way to win 2 more games, even if it's just Montgomery and Eovaldi winning all 4 games. Maybe Scherzer pops up in there. If the Diamondbacks are able to split, that makes things a lot more interesting. And I know I'm stating the obvious here, but I think the Rangers can beat the Diamondbacks in, essentially, I have faith that they're going to beat one of Gallen or Kelly, and they can win one of the other 2 games. So, it kind of reminds me of the Cardinals-Red Sox back in 2013, where, Wainwright and Waka, but then what else were you going to have? You had Lynn, you had Joe Kelly, and I was like, well, if the Red Sox can win the Wainwright or the Waka game in games 1 and 2, and then find a way to win a couple of a game on. They only won, they won 1 game in Boston, then they won 2 in St. Louis, then they won a game in game 6 in Boston. They beat Waka in game 6. So they actually beat Wainwright twice in that series, game 1 and 5. So, I've been bad at predicting things over the last year, but I think the Rangers can find a way to win this. As all due respect, as good as the Diamondbacks are, and the young talent, and I think they're managed well. There's things I don't always agree with Torey Lovallo, their manager, but he seems to do a good job. He seems to be connecting with these young players. I just think Bruce Bochy and these Rangers are a lot of veterans, a lot of guys who've been in the league a while. Bruce Bochy, who's obviously won. Seager, who's obviously played in the postseason a lot. I just think this team is made for it, and they're going to win this World Series. So that's my angle on it. I hope everybody enjoys the World Series. I know it's not the big, medium. It's funny because everyone says, I don't want to see the same teams all the time. And then now that we're here, people are complaining. We don't have the Red Sox. We don't have the Yankees. We don't have the Cubs. We don't have the Cardinals. We don't have the Dodgers or the Giants. It's like, well, you didn't want those teams. You want somebody new. Maybe you wanted a new David and Goliath? I don't know. Maybe you wanted a Yankees and a Diamondbacks again. 2001 World Series rematch. But I think this is good for baseball, this particular World Series. I don't think the playoff system is good for baseball, and I don't think expanding it further is. I don't like that the Brewers and the Twins had to play in the wild card series. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed having more baseball. I'm not going to lie and say, oh, it was terrible. No, it was great. It was fun to have. I think it diminishes winning your division. I think it diminishes winning the division series, because the division series was always fun being the opening series, but it was really just round two, and that's where, you know, your top two teams are playing. So, you know, you saw the Cardinals last year, and they had a fantastic season, and it went by the wayside because a hot six seed got in. I'm not just saying because it's the Cardinals. Look at, Minnesota did do their job, but Milwaukee didn't get to advance this year because this Diamondbacks team did. Actually, it's mirrored. The sixth seed beat the NL Central team, which for some people is saying, well, the NL Central needs to stop trying to build their team to win that division. They need to build their team as if they were trying to win one of the other divisions and to win the pennant. So hopefully my Cardinals do better. I think this particular matchup, you can agree with both. Both can be true. People think it's a zero-sum game. One thing has to be true and one thing has to be false. I think it can be bad for baseball that too many teams are getting in and low seeds are all beating the high seeds. And I can also say it's good to see these two teams in the World Series, teams that thought they had a chance to start the year, teams that were built for this sort of time of year. Young players, new stars. Adolis Garcia getting all the attention he's getting in a market like Texas where people aren't in baseball paying as much attention to Texas. So I think it's a good matchup. It'll be fun. Get some exposure for these teams. And, you know, I hope the Rangers win, but it should be a good World Series. I don't anticipate a sweep. This doesn't feel like Red Sox Rockies 2007, where they're like, all right, the Diamondbacks are happy to be in. The Rangers are going to take their heads off and just completely own them. It's possible, but I think we're going to have 5-6 games, maybe 7. So that's the World Series. When we come back, we are going to take a look at where things are in the NFL and how bad I really am at predicting things. So I'll be right back. Thanks for being with me and enjoy the World Series. This is StraussNet Sports Radio. Welcome back to StraussNet Sports Radio. That was our World Series preview segment. But let's look at the NFL and where we are right now. It is fall, the fall classic. Hockey has started. It's just started just enough to see, you know, some teams. Blues are interesting. They're kind of doing exactly what I thought. They're good, not great so far. The NBA just started last night or the night before. Celtics won with their new-look group with Porzingis and Drew Holiday, who they just got. I think losing Marcus Smart's personality is tough, but I think getting Drew Holiday, getting the talent, helps replace the man, even if it's not a guy who's ingrained the same way. So I think the Celtics, I said on the air yesterday, I think the Celtics can win the NBA. But let's look at the NFL, like I said. So I have my division right up. I remember on the last episode I said, I'm not going to predict the division because I'm bad at this. And I wrote all the divisions in order how I would do them. So let's talk about the AFC East. I said Buffalo, New England, Miami, and the Jets. Well, I didn't predict Aaron Rodgers to blow his Achilles out and potentially miss the whole year, and Zach Wilson to be back as the quarterback. I also didn't predict New England to fall flat on their face and look completely incompetent at every turn. Miami, on the other hand, I thought if they stay healthy, could be better than I had them ranked. They are leading their division, followed by Buffalo, those Jets, and the Patriots. How do I think it's going to turn out? I don't know. If I had to guess, I'd say as long as Miami stays healthy, they've got this division. Buffalo is still definitely a threat. It's going to be one of those two. I don't at this point think the Patriots or the Jets are playoff teams. Moving to the north, I said Cincinnati, Baltimore, Pittsburgh, Cleveland. It's Baltimore, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Cincinnati. Joe Burrow was hurt to start the year. A lot of people say, oh, this won't affect him that much. It affected him. That team has just been scuffling. Now, there's still time. And I also said Baltimore's going to be better because they got their quarterback back. So, Lamar Jackson. So, would I change anything? I might move Baltimore up to my prediction for the North winner, and then Cincinnati too. I think they can get back there. Cincinnati's 3-3. Pittsburgh and Cleveland are 4-2. They can easily get back to where they need to be, Cincinnati. The South, Jacksonville, Tennessee, Indy, Houston. It's actually Jacksonville, Houston, Indy, Tennessee. Tennessee's a mess. I'm sticking with Jacksonville. I could see, you know, the Indianapolis is interesting because their quarterback got hurt for the year, Richardson. So, you know, and Gardner Minshew's holding it down. Richardson should be good when he comes back, but I'm going to say Jacksonville. I don't know that anybody else is a... Tennessee's one of the teams I was hemming and hawing at if they were a playoff team because they've been the last couple of years, but Tennessee's out for me. I don't think any of those other teams make it. C.J. Stroud's been really good for Houston, but Jacksonville's who I'm sticking with there. So at this point, I'm not going to rewrite these predictions as like a mid-season thing. I wouldn't even say it's mid-season, but I'm going to say Miami or Buffalo, flip a coin. I still think either of them can win it, especially with Miami's health concerns every year. Cincinnati, Baltimore, I still say they're going to be the top two. The West, it's Kansas City's division to lose. I said that the whole way. I thought the Chargers would be better. They are not. Chiefs are 6-1. They just got Mecole Hardman back, so they got better. Vegas Raiders are 3-4. Chargers are 2-4. And Denver is a dumpster fire. I still think the Chargers can get better, but they've been a mess. If the playoffs started tomorrow, Miami, Kansas City, Baltimore, Jacksonville, and Pittsburgh, Cleveland, and Buffalo are your wild cards. So that's kind of nuts. In the NFC, I had Philly, Dallas, Giants, and Washington. The only change there is Washington's in last. I'm sorry, the Giants are in last, and Washington's in third. That can change. Dallas looked really good early, but kind of has not been as great recently. They won their last game, but I still think the Eagles are the class of that division. I think Dallas is better than people are claiming they are. You know, they started the year, Dallas is going to the Super Bowl. Now it's, oh, Dallas is a fraud. They're a sham. No, I think Dallas is still pretty good. The NFC North, I actually had the Bears in third place and Green Bay in last, and that's flipped. Everything about the North is flipped, but not on its head. I had Minnesota-Detroit. It's Detroit-Minnesota. Minnesota can still catch up. They are missing Justin Jefferson. They're playing a little better. They've said they're not trading Kirk Cousins. That's going to be the determining factor. I've been really impressed with Detroit and how well they've played. The Bears are a dumpster fire and should probably continue to be one. Green Bay is missing some things. I think Green Bay's looked better than the Bears have. The Bears, just their coaching is just a mess. I don't agree with almost anything they do. Justin Fields is going to waste. They're probably going to end up trading him and starting over again. This organization can't get out of its own way. I think Matt Nagy was better than some of the coaches they have now. I think Matt Nagy is good as an offensive coordinator and had trouble as a head coach dealing with all of it. But at this point, it's a mess. Eberflus is a mess. He doesn't seem to be firing the team up. After they finally won a game in months, he comes in with a list and goes, so here are the things we needed to do today. We needed to tackle and get the football, and did we do all that? Yeah, good job. On to the next one. It's like, you know, even Bill Belichick comes in and says, that was a great effort out there, and we really played, you know. Dude read from a piece of paper. That team's a mess. Burn him to the ground. Start over. Poor Justin Fields. You know, who knows? The NFC South was interesting to me. I said New Orleans would win this division. Now, any of these teams but Carolina can win the division. I actually had Carolina, too. I thought Bryce Young had come in, and that's what was going to get them over the top to be a good team. I thought they'd finish in second. Pardon me if I just said I thought they would win the division. Now, they're being second in this division. I'm dead wrong on that. They're in last place. They just don't have enough pieces, I guess. I thought Carolina would be a little better. I thought they'd be in the pack here. I pretty much thought the whole division would be like it was last year, where everybody was in the pack. And three of the teams are, and Carolina's not. So if you take Carolina out of... Actually, I didn't have them in the... I had them in the two-spot asterisk. I had Atlanta finishing in last. So here's how I wrote it. New Orleans, Carolina, Atlanta, Tampa, asterisk. I was not impressed with the Baker Mayfield signing. I thought that, you know, they were just kind of, you know, I thought maybe Mike Evans got traded. There was a lot going on there. But I said, if things went well in Tampa, Tampa could finish two. I'm going to say they could finish the division winner right now. It's Atlanta, Tampa, New Orleans, Carolina. I thought New Orleans would be better than this. I thought getting Derek Carr would really help. But Tampa Bay has impressed me. They've looked pretty good. I like their system. I know they're only 500 right now, but they can be better. I think they can win this division. I think Atlanta's only winning it because somebody else hasn't stepped up. No, they don't have Tom Brady in Tampa, but Baker's done a good job. He's playing happy again. He's playing free again. So I think, you know, my prediction of Tampa as the number two team, I think that was correct. I was going back and forth on them. If you go back and listen to that episode, I was talking about how I thought Tampa could be the two seed in this, the number two team in this division, and I was pretty confident that if this worked out, that they would be the two seed. It wouldn't be like, well, if Baker's good, they'll be a three. No, they're going to be the number two in this division, or have a chance to win it. I thought New Orleans would win this division, but if Baker Mayfield didn't work out, they'd be in last place. Well, they're in second. New Orleans is in third. Atlanta's playing best right now, but you know, we'll see who gets back on top. The division games are going to really determine this division. Pretty much, it's the same as it was last year, where the team that finishes over 500 is probably going to go to the playoffs. It's not a great division. Tampa has a shot. Now, out west, I said San Francisco and the Rams, then Seattle and Arizona. Arizona is 1-6, so I'm right about that. San Francisco's 5-2. Brock Purdy finally lost. I said, what is Brock Purdy? Well, here, I'll tell you what Brock Purdy is. He's not Tom Brady. He's not Zach Wilson either. He's, no disrespect to Zach Wilson, I think he's very talented, but it's just not working for him. I think Brock Purdy is in the perfect system for him. He's a good quarterback. I think he's probably a Kirk Cousins. A very good quarterback. Needs to be in a good system. Can win. And he's very mentally tough. And I think San Francisco is, I still like San Francisco and Philly to go back to the NFC Championship this year. Seattle's played a little better than the Rams. The Rams have kind of, here's the thing about the Rams. I thought Matt Stafford would be better this year, and he has been, but they've started selling off some assets to try to reboot it. So my prediction was based on that roster. They've sold off. They're in third place. Seattle's moved to second place. So even though I feel like I've done horrible on my predictions, I haven't done all that bad. I was dead wrong about the Patriots, and that's what really hurts. So if I'm looking at things right now, I'm saying Philly and San Francisco are still my Super Bowl contenders. Over on the AFC side, I like Kansas City, I like Baltimore, and I like Miami. And I like them better than Buffalo. Buffalo can get together, but they just look like they're a bit off. Like they've hit their peak and, you know, I don't know what they're doing, but I like Baltimore. Look at how good Baltimore was back when Lamar Jackson was healthy a few years ago. I think because of that, they can really be a contender. But, you know, Kansas City's defense is really helping them. They may have lost some receivers, but I think the Kansas City defense has made all the difference. So that's where we're at in football. You know, NHL carrying on. Let's take a brief look at the NHL standings while we're at. Red Wings are in second place in their division. Rangers lead their division. Rangers only lead their division by a point. Remember, point standings in the NHL. 2 points for a win, none for a loss, one for an overtime or shootout loss. Bruins lead the Atlantic 12 points, Red Wings 11. Then Toronto and Tampa have 8. In the Metropolitan, the Rangers 8, Philly, Jersey, and Columbus all have 7. Over in the West, in the Central, our Blues sit in second to last place in front of the Blackhawks. 12 points for Colorado, 9 for Dallas, 7 for Minnesota. I'm going to be honest, Connor Bedard looks really like he's going to be a really good player. He's really polite, really professional, and I am sick of hearing about him. I am tired of them being on every couple nights on ESPN like they are the best team in the league. And this just reminds me of the late 2000s and early 2010s where the Blackhawks were all the time, but they were really, really good. They're not good this year. That's why they've got the kid. And I am tired of hearing about how great this kid is, because it's like, hey, why don't you focus on some of the teams that are really good? So we'll see how that coverage goes on. Again, I'm not trying to disrespect the Blackhawks. I'm not disrespecting Connor Bedard. I'm disrespecting the media for hyping up the, you know, McDavid 2.0 question mark. So that's the Central. In the Pacific, Vegas, defending champions, have 14. Vancouver, 8. Los Angeles Kings, 7. If I remember right, Vegas played Florida in the Stanley Cup Final. Florida is tied for, however you look at it, last, third to last. 6 points for Ottawa, Florida, and Buffalo. But again, it's so early in the season. You have a good week. Everything changes. You know, Columbus is currently in a wild card spot, and Arizona if the playoffs start today. So we'll see. You know, we'll see how that goes. But the Blues are only being in last place, second to last place in their division, are 1 point out of a playoff spot. So it's way too early to even think about talking about playoffs at this stage. But for now, that's kind of going to wrap it up. I'll come back for some off-season talk for baseball, some hockey talk. I don't know if I'm going to get one next month in November or not. We'll see. Things are busy. Maybe after the World Series, we'll talk about it. But until then, go enjoy the World Series. Pick a team. I encourage you, even if you're a fan of the Cubs, the Cardinals, the White Sox, the Dodgers, the Red Sox, Oakland, pick a team in this World Series. Enjoy it. Root for someone. That's what it's about. It's about having fun. And, you know, I hope the Rangers win, but hats off to the Diamondbacks if they do. I think it's good for baseball to see some new teams. It's weird. Like I said, I don't like the playoff format. But it's also nice to see some new faces and not just the Astros again or the Dodgers who are in it every year. So enjoy this World Series. We'll talk to you later. You have been listening to StraussNet Sports Radio. We weren't born to follow. Come on and get up off your knees.